But now moving forward, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be proceeding into a panel discussion. And you see, in this ever-changing world of marketing, it's very unlikely that marketers will still stick to the same approach. It's no longer the big getting the small. It's no longer the elephant getting the tiger. It's about the fast getting the slower. It's about the tiger getting the deer. And with some new thoughts, some new secrets, we'd like to move in and talk to you about secrets of marketing in the new interactive age. And this panel discussion would be chaired by Mr. Shivjeet, Kullar, founder for attitude.com. He's an ad guru, is a legendary author, playwriter, jingle man, and a serial entrepreneur who has won over 100 national and international awards over the course of his career. He has worked with the best brands in India and has been rated as one of the top 10 most high profile creative names in India by the Campaign magazine. Shivjeet is now making a difference in the world of communication with his third startup, which is Attitude, named as one of the hottest startup by many experts, including Economic Times, CEO Magazine, and NASCOM. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the chairperson for our panel discussion, Mr. Shivjeet Kullar. Very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. So I think he's told you all the good facts about me. I'll tell you some of the stuff you should also know. I spent 30 years in advertising, in JWT, in Lintas, Clarion, Bates. I was a writer. I was possibly the worst behaved creative director in advertising throughout my career. I had clients who would throw me out of rooms. I had bosses who would fire me. But I really enjoyed advertising. One day, after I thought I was done with advertising and was leading a peaceful life, I had worked in advertising, I had sold an agency, I woke up with an idea for a startup. And it was an idea which was called Users Play, Clients Pay. So it basically was people who came and played like an advertising game, and ads, Pepsi, ITC, Whirlpool, they all give us ads to test. And because we were doing it this way, we could do testing much faster and cheaper than anybody else. So I took this idea, and at that time my son, raise your hand, Veer. Yeah, there he is. So he used to be in digital, and he used to tell me, Dad, stay out of digital. That is my area. Don't get into this. I didn't listen to him, and I have suffered for 5 years. I haven't slept much for 5 years, because that's what a startup is like. One of the greatest shocks that I got, and that's why I was explaining to my fellow panelists, was that at that time, 5 years back, when you went to people and said, I have a very quick way of testing your advertising or your brand or your communication, half of them didn't want to know. So somebody said, boss, maine 4 crore ka film banaya hai, ab TV pe hai, ab koi testers mat kijiye, I'll be in trouble. So half of the people didn't want to know how the advertising is or how their storyboards were. I think what has happened today is that has all changed. And advertising and marketing and digital are all converging. And that's the topic we're going to deal with today. So I'm going to call up my fellow panelists onto the stage. And as we sit down, each will give a 1 minute introduction on themselves and what they do. And then we are going to have a chat, but whoever's timing us, please keep enough time for questions and answers, because we think it's best if dialogue flows both ways. So I want you to give a big round of applause as I call each of the, not for me, Aramidesh, for these people, I call people on the stage. First, I'll call on Tanuja Pradhan from Jio. Tanuja. Come, sit. Now I'd like to invite Anuja Mishra from PepsiCo. Always first the ladies, huh? The whistleblowers are the women of the year, if you read in the Time magazine. Then Prashant from Yum Brands, Prashant Gaur. And last but not the least, Manik from Max Life. Okay, so here we are, we're all set. We're going to try and keep it crisp, keep it moving, and try and give you an insight on the new secrets of marketing. Not the old ones which you find in the textbooks, a lot of which are invalid, but the new stuff and what's going on. So I thought we'll start by each of the panel members introducing themselves, telling us something about what they do, and telling us one thing that the world doesn't know about them. Let's just make this interesting. Okay, so we'll do short introductions, starting with the ladies, of course. Their mics in front of you. So you want to start, Anuja?
Tanuja, and I have around 16 years of work experience across different functions of marketing, consulting. If you talk about industry, so I have done a lot of work in telecom, real estate, FMCG, and few more. One thing which nobody knows is I also have a solo pilot license. So that's okay.
Give her a hand of applause. It's a pilot here.
Yeah. Thank you.
Lovely.
Hi everybody, I'm Anuja Mishra, about a work experience of about 13 years across primarily the FMCG space. Currently work with PepsiCo and lead their hydration, energy and innovation portfolio for beverages. This is a very interesting space because as a beverage category, there are a lot of interesting learnings that are kind of coming to the forefront. And happy to talk about them in a while. There is very little that people don't know about me, but yes, I think something that most of you wouldn't know is that I'm a full marathoner and run a marathon pretty much once 3 months.
Okay, that's great.
My name is Manik. Hi. I work for a company that helps people express their love for their families. We sell life insurance. I've been around for many years in financial services. And I have a guru nowadays when I engage with customers, and that guy is 10 years old. He's my benchmark for curiosity. He's my benchmark for learning new things. He's my benchmark to be comfortable with the changing ways of the world and adopting very, very quickly what technology makes possible. That's my 10-year-old son. And I'm truly intrigued with the pace and the dexterity with which they're evolving.
What's his name? This.
His name is Aryan, sir. Aryan.
Aryan. Okay, great. Thanks. Prashant?
Hello, everyone. Audible? So my name is Prashant Gaur. I work with a company which makes the best pizzas in town and in the country. So I head marketing for Pizza Hut. It's been close to 2 years with Yum Brands and with Pizza Hut. I not only head marketing, but also look after technology. So that's one unique combination that I have as a job description. Typically, marketers are known for creativity, but I also have technology as part of my portfolio. One thing slightly off, slightly unique, different about me is the way I started my career. So I'm an engineer. Straight after my engineering, I got a job with Mahindra British Telecom. It's an IT firm, it used to be.
I didn't like that work stream, so I came back to Jaipur and I joined an NGO. So my journey from working with an NGO to heading a brand like Pizza Hut has been amazing, and I think not many people know about that journey. So thank you.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so we are going to now get into the meat of the discussion. I think, has anybody here heard of the Mika report? The yearly Mika report? Okay. Where is Mika report, right? Mary Mika. It is the Bible for trends, communication trends in the world. And this time, for the first time ever, the Mika report has reported that internet advertising in the world has overtaken TV advertising. This is the first time ever. I'm going to start with a general interesting question to each of the panelists. And the question is, how do they relate with the internet? So it's actually a personal question. It could have something to do with Facebook, something to do with research, something to do with, you know, playing something with their son. So each of them will take a minute and tell us what is their personal way of interacting with the internet. And this time we can start with Manik.
Tough, I mean, you know, it's become so tough to, Shivjeet, take out internet from your lives and try and figure out the many ways in which it is intertwined with a whole lot of stuff that you do, whether it is searching for information or searching for opinions or engaging with some of the others. Actually, a medium that interacts has obviously a lot more power to hold attention at a very fundamental human level. Which is why, to my mind, it's not surprising at all that as consumers' attentions captured by the medium more and more, advertisers also find it worth their while to shift their attention there to a medium. The other way I look at it is that, you know, nobody ever started or referred to a discipline as TV marketing or radio marketing. And so I find it a little out of place because fundamentally I want to reach a consumer. And basis how the consumer is spending their time and attention with what size of the screen or print or otherwise is then the approach for a marketer to do exactly that. And so if one were to walk consumer backwards, it is pretty intuitive that as attention spans go there, you engage much more there.
Okay, so his interaction with the internet is the fascination of observing how the internet itself, apart from what you do, it changes you to a great degree. And any favorite sites like that we wouldn't know? Any favorite website that you visit?
The kind of content, for instance, that LinkedIn offers, and I spend a good amount of time in a week there. The fact that there is an algorithm at the back curating content basis your consumption, basis your interest areas and all of that, I find it extremely useful. Because in the old days, for instance, if you wanted to curate or read up on a particular subject or area of interest, the amount of hard work that you would have to do then and now is significantly reduced, because what you're doing with the digital footprint is that you're leaving those trails. Someone else is using it to your benefit, curating it in a manner and serving it to you exactly how you want it.
Okay, so he likes LinkedIn. So now we'll ask the marathon runner. Okay, so Arija, how do you interact with the internet?
Shivjeet, you know, when you asked this question, I actually sort of went a little into a fix, because it's a little like asking, how do you find breathing? Suddenly now, you know, the whole internet proliferation has become so inherent to our lives that it's a little difficult to possibly imagine, you know, your life without it, or, you know, even dissect it possibly. But maybe the way I'd address this question is at two folds. One is, I think, as a consumer of the internet, And the second is maybe as a marketer, because it's possibly a, you know, it's a, you're in the skin of both at some level. You know, the fact that man is a social animal was never more true than now, right? With the staggering data points, and I'm sure you know all of us know the data points, like 450 million internet users and, you know, 300 million smartphone users and so on and so forth. It's obviously intriguing to say the least. But I guess what it's, you know, at the core of it, really, what it's telling us is a very simple thing. Every human being, and possibly the youth, you know, this is more reflective of the youth, are looking for essentially two things: information and experiences. And that's exactly what the web or the internet is bringing to you. And I think that's where I kind of draw my learning as a marketer. You know, like, you know, I think even Manik rightly mentioned, it's not about a particular forum or a particular platform, it's about marketing to your consumers. And to that extent, you know, you have to be changing and interacting the way your consumers are changing. And the fact that, you know, the whole digital medium is so predictive, you know, it can literally assess, you know, what you like, what you don't like. It's scary at the same, but it's so predictive. I think that's the really interesting piece about it, on how do you kind of pick up those nuances and integrate your brand into the lives of people. So in the whole digital piece, I think, is in a way just personifying individuals. When we were advertising on television, it was a faceless audience. Today, every consumer literally has a face that you could look at.
So that's interesting. So in she's reckoning that actually the internet in some ways is making humans more human, which is a pretty interesting take. Now we'll hear from the lady who has the brand that scared the hell out of all the brands, right? Telecom brands. Oof, we're all quaking in their boots. So, Tanuja, what is your relationship with the net? What is your first comment on the internet?
Yes, so, you know, in my current role, you know, I look after consumer insights and also the, you know, technology intervention in different marketing. So for me, it has become bread and butter, where I'm invariably on internet. And something which has changed, you know, the traditional way of consumer insights is, we in Jio, we don't do any brand tracks per se. So now, because, you know, everybody used to say the brand is what consumers speak to each other. So that has become true, because now, you know, your internet, through internet, you can track what's happening right there. So you don't have to wait for a month to get the feedback on your campaigns. You don't have to wait to see if your campaigns are, you know, making some impact, relevance, etc. So that is the reason why I'm glued on the internet. Also, you know, I'm just staying one step back and talking about interactivity, as the name says, you know, of our session. I don't think it is right to say that this is the age of interactivity. We as a consumer were always ready to interact. You know, when companies, they send salesmen to their premier customers, it was the premise that they want to interact with the, you know, their brand per se. Then came the call centers, then it was bombarded with, you know, consumer calls. Then we had the Gini call internet, where, oh, we were vowed that, you know, salesmen memory is not an issue. So the internet or the computer also stored what was the historic transaction, and we vowed the consumer, saying, oh, he knows me, you know, what I spoke last time. Now there's an era of app, so where, you know, interaction is not limited to what has happened. It also expected us to, you know, predict based on all the interaction, tell me what next. So as a consumer, we were always interactive. Just that, you know, today with the multi options which have come into the market in terms of the technology intervention, the multiple touch points for the consumers, and also multiple substitutes for each and every product category. So the interactivity has completely opened up a new era of consumer conversation. When we said the brand is built when consumer speaks to consumer, that is the era which is happening today.
So that's a take where she's saying that what was there before is now being amplified. There was interactivity, but it's just moving to a whole new level. So the internet, I think what Tanuja is saying, is a natural evolution of what was happening before. Okay, so now we will hear from Prashant, who represents a product I'm no longer allowed to eat because of my weight. But for all you guys who love pizzas, here's the man who markets them and his take, first take on his relationship with the internet.
Yeah, so I'll first answer this question as a father, then as an individual, and then as a marketer. So as a father, I can't even imagine a world without internet. Every single day, every single meal that my 6.5-year-old daughter has, it is not possible without internet. So I mean, it has become part of our lives. I can't imagine taking out time to convince her to engage in certain activities, and especially having food without internet. So that's more as a father. As an individual, I like to play tennis, and I like to play and learn guitar, and I don't have a coach. I don't have any guitar teacher who comes and teaches me. So I pick these things straight from YouTube. It's very easy. I can just type how to serve like Federer. Of course, I can't serve like him, but there are online tutorials that you can literally access. Other is also, as an individual, internet gives me a lot of empowerment. Today, and I can imagine how I used to travel with my family 5 years back versus how do I travel today. 5 years back, 7 years back, whenever you land into any foreign territory, you would ensure that you have the hotel address, you have the printed map of that city. Today, I know that I have my smartphone, which has the data pack. If I want to book a cab, I can do that. If I have to access any place, I can do that. So I'm not dependent on anybody else. Internet is one medium through which I can find any answer that I'm looking for. Lastly, as a marketer, we have already discussed that how easy internet has made all of us to reach out to our consumers in no time, and also to pick those valuable insights in real-time basis. And also from a consumer standpoint, especially if you look at social media, one is to look at social media as a medium to interact with your friends, family, and friends of friends. But other way to look at social media is giving access to everybody, and equal access to everybody. So today it doesn't matter whether the guy is or the person is sitting out of Delhi or a small town, everybody has equal access to this world of internet. And they probably see internet and social media more as a platform wherein they can display their talent, they can put it out for rest of the world to see it. And other is, it also acts as an equalizer. It gives everybody a level playing field. So it doesn't matter whether I have 400 stores on ground and the other guy has 1,000, both the brands will only have one site, one M site. So it is a great leveler.
I really like it when somebody senior in marketing gives a very simple answer to the question. I want a round of applause for this answer. Give us a round of applause. Super. So simply and well put. So I'm now going to give my panelists a minute to consider the next question, which is that tomorrow you are interviewing somebody who's getting into marketing, and he's standing in front of you, or she's standing in front of you, and you have to tell her in this new age a secret. Like, when you approach marketing, this is something you must keep in mind. So while I tell the audience a joke, you guys just spend a minute, because this is what we're going to do. It's like somebody's asking you, hey, I'm getting into marketing, tell me something, and you got to tell them, and something substantial, not beating around the bush. Oh, keep in mind, left is right and right is left. Some great thing which will land somebody here a job. Okay, meanwhile, I will tell you an interesting little story about the internet. So currently, that young chap, my son, as I told you, he heads our digital marketing. When he was 6 years old, he came to me, and I was on my computer, and he says, Dad, I said, yeah. He says, you have an email account. I said, yeah. He said, Mom has an email account. I said, yeah. He says, Tanya has got 4 email accounts. So Tanya made 4 email, I don't know why she made 4. I said, that's right. So he looked at me very worried and said, will there be enough room on the internet for me? So I assured him There would be. So now we're going to deal with a question, which is, since we are here to give you secrets of marketing the new age, what would be a key secret to tell somebody who wants to join marketing? Some strategy they should keep in mind. Anybody can just kick off. You should kick off.
My very honest advice to a young marketer would be to not get intimidated by platforms and, you know, the jargons. Irrespective of how we evolve and irrespective of how platforms evolve, I think as a marketer, what you need to always remember is that some fundamentals don't change. The fact that there needs to be a brand promise, a brand purpose, and a very sharp brand positioning can never change despite, the platform changing. You could be marketing to somebody online, offline, on television, on radio. There has to be consistency in your communications. I think that's one message that as a marketer, and it's not a secret really, but I think just something that I would want everyone to be reminded of.
Okay, so for me it is about, never forget the importance of human element in front of whether it's a product or technology, everything. But at the end of the day, the human aspect in your communication is must. It is about the relevance, empathy, be empathetic. So yeah, you may have different platform, you may have, let's say Facebook, social media, etc., but there you cannot say, I'll just take one example. So for JioKBC per se, the human element was everybody, thought that if they were on the hot seat, they would have played better than the guy who was doing it. And that was the insight which we took, which was about the entertainment and the gamification. So for us, never forget the human element in entire communication. Technology and platform and the, everything can be taken care of.
Thank you.
I think I got the question wrong, but if the question was, if I'm interviewing someone and if I have to ask one question to that person.
So you're interviewing someone.
Yeah.
And you have to give them a secret.
Sure.
For their future career, where
sure.
They should definitely get a job, and one of them is definitely going to use your secret, and if they don't get a job, they're going to sue you. So you have to give something good.
All right. So one is, just adding, building up to this, and probably sticking to the thing that I have in my mind is, it is also important to ask someone as a marketer when you're meeting folks, especially folks who are interested in technology and digital, as to define who your competitors are. So if I meet someone and the person tells me that your competition is actually ABC pizza brands, for a job in the digital marketing space, I would say that person is out. He's not in my consideration set, because my competition, by definition of it, is of course the other pizza brands and the other QSR brands. But when it comes to digital, my competition is Ola, my competition is Amazon, my competition is Facebook. So I think that is one nuance I would like to share with everybody, that it's very important to understand that the entire landscape changes dramatically. And other is more of the insight that at least we guys play on today sounds complicated, which is the mindset that we are talking to is the IWWI. Sounds very complicated, but what it means is the mindset that we are talking to today is the generation which says to us, which tells us that I want what I want when I want it. So that is the mindset. They want everything as per their desire, at the time when they want, in the form and shape that they want. So marketers have to oblige to that. Sorry, I probably deviated from the core, but I thought maybe I'll just add two bits on that.
I think that's interesting advice, right, Lisa? Good advice, right? Okay, go for it.
My advice to youngsters would be simply this, is to focus on the consumer journey for your product, for your category, and focus attention and energies on what is it that the consumer goes through in the decision-making cycle for your category, for your product. What are the pain points? Where is it that they feel joy? Where is it that they need reassurance? Where is it that they need more information? Where is it they need samples? so on and so forth. And some of this is very basic. And not focus so much on what technology can make possible, because all of those answers will emerge, and there are many people to provide those answers. But the unique and obvious insight on where as marketing strategy would you want to differentiate, what part of the journey would you overmanage, and how would you give your consumer a compelling experience is what is paramount.
Thanks. Okay, so let's do an interesting thing. Is everybody, can everybody hear everything over here? Everybody? Yeah. Everybody learning anything here? Raise your hands. Okay, so you guys are not learning. We'll do something for you. Now, everybody here represents a brand, and everybody has their own brand story to tell. I think it would be interesting if each one of you, I can't say us, as moderating is really bad, you can't talk about yourself. Each one of you gives us an example of something you admire that another brand is doing. So not your own brand, but when you look around the landscape, and you know, it could be anything, it could be from Modi to someone else, but could you give us a thought that, hey, I like what this brand does? Because to me, that in a way is a lot more believable than us talking about our own brand. You know, we do this so well, all right? So what is it that you feel that you've seen? Like, I'll give you guys an example. Anybody has heard of the First Kiss, the disruptor video? So there's this brand of clothing who was launching abroad. I think it was called Elhart Clothing. And they didn't want to do a fashion show. They said, like, fashion shows, been there, done that, it's done. So they took 22 strangers and made them stand opposite each other, 11-11, wearing their clothing, and made them kiss for the first time in their lives. So guy, girl, the whole, in US, anything goes. And they got 42 million hits on this one thing. So you needn't give as specific an example. It could be, okay, Pons did Gang of Girls, it could be anything. But just let's hear something which you think another brand is doing very well, hopefully, possibly with the internet in it. Any of you?
Yeah, so the obvious one that comes to my mind is also a brand that I literally use every single day, which is Uber. My choice is basis the ease, the convenience, and the empowerment this brand has given. Imagine they send a cab at a click of a button, and they just don't own any single taxi, right? And a recent thing that I picked up as to what they are doing as a brand is, of course, they are increasing their penetration in metros and smaller towns. But they're also now, shifting the entire game towards shared economy. I think that's a very nice nuance that at least I have picked up. They also understand that, you know, with so much of emission, pollution, etc., coming into our lives, they are pushing the agenda of sharing and the sharing economy. So while 10 on 10 as far as technology is concerned, but they also are now playing a larger sustainable game, which I quite appreciate.
I think a brand that I really admire, and again, this comes from the food and beverage industry, is Oreo. You know, Oreo is a 100-year-old brand. It's a cookie brand, right? And what would we think about a cookie? But the fact that that brand is so relevant on social media, more importantly, not just relevant, but relevant through the core of the product. You know, so everything that they do on social is always anchored and centered around the product, you know, around just that circular cookie and the interesting things that they do. And that's an amazing example of, you know, how you don't have to necessarily be a tech brand to be cool on social. You know, you can be as relevant with the core of your product with the consumers anytime.
The Ford Motor Company in India, there's a phenomenal job of integrating the online and the offline part of purchasing a car kind of journey. You know, if you look at it, there are your journey starts with a generic kind of a search saying SUV less than 20 lakhs. And then you shortlist a couple of brands, and then you go out and you say, all right. And now there's the physical part of the journey, which is the test drive. So did the car come on time? Was it clean? So on and so forth. And then you go into a more refined kind of search that says, all right, ground clearance for this brand, and weight to power ratio, and mileage, and so on and so forth. And then it's the social media leg, where you say, how's the service? And what's the cost of ownership? And that, stuff like that. And then there's the other physical leg again, where you go to the showroom, and you know, you ask him for that keychain free, and you tell him, mats laga de, you know, wo laga de. Mud guards laga de and all of that, and how he reacts to that or not. They're so phenomenally tied in. Right at the inception of the generic search, to the branded search, to the social media, and the final culmination at the showroom, which is the physical part. As unique identity for the consumer, they've tailored messaging across the funnel depending on where you are in your decision cycle. They've also made sure that your experience is omnichannel, so that there are ways that the dealer recognizes you as you start to engage with the physical part of the journey. And they've got awesome ROI for the way they have spent, the audiences that they have spoken to, and the kind of impact that they've had.
Okay, for me again, it's an automobile brand, which is Fiat. So, you know, they're so strong on their brand philosophy, what they have done in, you know, abroad, that they have gone beyond the category, and to ensure the safety of drivers during night drive, they have actually opened Fiat suites on the highways. So when you are tired, you can actually go and use your Fiat key and check in into that hotel, take rest for 4-5 hours and check out in the morning. So that actually shows that, you know, for the core of their philosophy, they have gone beyond just being in the category. And when you talk about their, you know, digital activation or something with the technology, so in one of the countries, they also came up with an app called Fiat Safe Key. The moment you put your, car key in, the moment you start it, it actually monitors your speed. It monitors traffic, and if you're over speeding, it does alarm you. So that is the integration, which is fantastic, because, you know, especially may not be in India, but abroad there are concerns on teen driving, and for parents, and that app is installed on parents' phone as well, where they can monitor if the kiddie is driving fast. So they ensure that their brand philosophy of safety, you know, gets across in different platforms.
So now we will shift to each of the panelists giving us an example from their own brands, from initiatives they're doing, from any heartwarming interactive session or angle of the consumer. I'll tell you a story about our brand, which I found incredible. So our brand, as I mentioned, is attitude.com, where users come on and you see a film. It could be a commercial or it could be a behavioral film, basically saying what do you feel about insurance, this, that, etc. I'm pitching business to you. Huh? We should do some business. Yeah, cool. So you do that and then you win some points, and then a data report comes, like the analysts do a data report, and that's what happened. There was this father. So you win these loyalty points. There was a letter we got from a father asking us if we could donate his daughter's reward points, and she had a lot of them, to charity because she had died. You know, when I saw that letter, and first of all, that girl had accumulated, so you get prizes from your points. And the fact somebody should be so involved with your brand to actually ask this question, I really love that. And on the flip side of it, we give prizes. We give a car out every 2 months, not Fords and all, but small cars. And and that ensures in a big way that the data is authentic, you know, because no point giving wrong name, wrong this thing. So. Sanchik won the car in South India. I don't know what her name was. When we went to give the car, we found her name and address, all right, but she was 63 years old, and she's actually said she's 30. So because of our rules, we couldn't give it. She was like, so, bachchon ne bola thoda kam rakho age, and we just couldn't give it to her. Okay, so now we're going to hear from them, and please listen carefully. These people together represent salaries that are bigger than the African nation's yearly budget. Okay, these are the best that you got. So
that was a fake thing.
So they will each, they will, Rwanda, yeah, earns nothing, must be all.
Don't see. Amplify.
So they will each tell us something that they're doing with their brand, given the internet, which they found interesting, or something they're planning to do with their brands. Let's start off from that side.
So I can tell you, Kullar sahab, ek to aapka perception bada galat hai salaries ke baare mein. But I hope somebody is recording this so I can play it to my boss. What we did last year is that we were faced with a unique situation. Life insurance is not a business that's like food and travel and doesn't naturally lend itself, for instance, to digital consumption. Right? It's also not an intuitive need. You don't wake up one morning and say, "Aaj main 38 critical illness cover karne wala ek aisa plan lunga jo you know disability pe bhi dega aur heart attack pe bhi dega paisa aur critical illness pe bhi dega." And so it's about nudging somebody into consciousness and saying, "What if?" Now, what if is better done face to face when I look at you. And so we needed a moving kind of a conversation. So that's one part. And then there are that percentage of people who are coming online to search for solutions, for insurance solutions. And after many permutations and combinations, we found that it's a function of what your brand stands for, what's the price point, what's the proposition, and what's the experience. As would usually be the case for most brands that are transacting online in a direct-to-consumer business. And here, there is this other thing about us being an intermediary-led.
Keep your mouth nearer to your mic. It's drifting away from you.
Right. We are an intermediary-led business. For instance, usually, there'd be a seller involved. So the choice we had was, because we had 5% market share, to say, let's play in the preference funnel and try and tell people we're better in simple marketing terms, or expand the category, because anyways not too many people were searching for life insurance or critical illness or cancer insurance. And after much soul searching, we thought we'll take the bold thing of expanding the category. And the traditional marketing logic would say, if you're 5% and LIC is 50%, don't try to expand the category, the larger benefit will go there. And we said, all right, we're doing this only direct to consumer and digital. So hopefully we should have a measurement ecosystem to know who we nudged, where is he or she in the purchase funnel, what should be the sequence of conversations that we should have with them, so that when they're ripe for their decision, they're more likely to consider us, the brand that nudged them in the first place, than anybody else. And so, cutting one year and 16 months of effort in between, on March 31st, as we finished the last fiscal, we ended with approximately one third of the category, which means in direct to consumer protection as a category, we were 33%, one out of the three direct term plans sold in the country were from Max Life, and this includes LIC. And a lot of that had to do with the fact that we started to expand the category and started to have nudge conversations right at the top of the funnel, even though there are brands like ICICI, HDFC, and State Bank of India that are much, much larger, much stronger from a consumer consideration point of view.
Good move, bold move.
I think one of the very recent examples that I'd like to share with you all, and before I do that, you know, a caveat, I think most of us in the room would tend to think that brands like, brands from PepsiCo would typically be large A&M, you know, big brands present on television. I think we're challenging ourselves, and pretty much the landscape is challenging us to look at things differently. So very recently, about a couple of months ago, we launched a vitamin-fortified beverage called Aquafina Vitamin Splash. And the entire idea there is to, you know, speak with people who are wellness-oriented, who are looking for, you know, lifestyle beverages, who are, you know, looking for choices towards a healthier lifestyle. And we made a very conscious choice. We said we will not go television out. You know, this is not going to be a mass media attempt. So of course, you know, I mean, there while digital allows you to go very targeted, very sharp, you know, YouTube lets you sort of do a word search and then put your content out there. A very interesting, you know, thing, and it's actually very logical and very obvious and very commonsensical, is that digital also allows you to integrate offline, your offline interventions extremely well with your online interventions. So what are the kind of places where consumers are thinking about wellness or thinking about health? You know, let's say it's at a spa, it's at a salon, you know, it's when you really sort of want to relax. It's at a parlor, it's when you go shopping into the modern trade kind of channels. So we tapped all those channels where consumers would be in a positive frame of mind to look for wellness kind of, you know, products. We also brought on board a large army of influencers, you know, to just sort of try the product, and very organically a lot of them have come back and spoken about the product. But fundamentally, I think the really big learning, and it's not again a secret, but a big learning is that the whole interactive age also means interacting with the consumer's ecosystem. So we've literally now planted Vitamin Splash in the relevant consumers. So we've identified about 6.5 million consumers. And our entire point is about reaching out to that consumer through multiple touch points. You know, catch them at a modern trade store through geofencing. When they're at a salon, you know, let them try the product. Get the sort of right influencers to talk to them at the right kind of events. Sample the product at a lot of these fashion events where, you know, again, it's all about looking good. So I think fundamentally, you know, that's a big shift that we're making. And for PepsiCo as an organization, almost 30% of our spends today is on digital, which is a drastic move, Shivjeet, from about 3 years ago, maybe.
Okay, so we're going to hear the two remaining views, and then we're going to be finished with speaking time. We'll take questions. But I'm going to have a last question for each of these distinguished panelists, which will be, if you were to launch a site, what would it be? So they have to keep this in their mind. You can give it a name, you can tell us, but that'll be your last question. And you got to give us, okay, I do this. Okay? Let's finish the last 2 years.
Yeah. So for Jio, I would go back to the same example, Jio KBC, which was, you know, a play along platform where, you know, the insight was that everybody, you know, wanted to play, interact, and we wanted to create a second screen while people were watching TV. There was a time when 4 million users, they played together at same time on Jio, you know, play along. In total, we crossed more than 30 million users who played with us. And that is the best platform or the best showcase of interactivity coming from Jio.
Great.
Yeah, so I know we have just 42 seconds left. I talked about the mindset, the always on, I want what I want when I want it mindset, and their expectations from the category, which is actually category agnostic, and the impact that it has on brands. So one clear observation insight is that easy is today beating better. So if you're not easy, then you're not relevant, hence easy is beating better. So I'm just talking about impacts that it is having on our business, on our brand, on our category. Other is looking at how fast the online world is changing, and so are our consumers. Earlier we used to make 18 to 24 months marketing calendars. We still make those, but the real meat of those marketing calendars is just true for 3 months. So we keep a very tight eye on what is the marketing calendar for the next 3 months. Rest all is more of a theory, more of, you know, keeping things trigger ready. There is a significant shift from 35 seconders TVCs to 6 seconder YouTube campaigns. and also the real-time consumer read. So while we still continue to do brand imagery track reports, the insights come only after 8 weeks. Rather, we would log on to Google Analytics or Google Analytics 360. That's going to give you real-time update on the health of the business. So all of these changes are happening as we speak. Even copy test. Earlier, for example, in my category, I know that buy one, get one is the wild card that we can play. Is there a better way I can represent the same offer? Earlier, I had to go for a printer. Today, I can just do a copy test. Buy one, get one free. Buy two at 50%, blah, 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 on Google. And within a matter of a couple of hours, I'll get to know which is the best copy, which is the winning copy. So all of these are impact at an org level, the way we work, the way marketers look at the marketing strategy, even impact on org. For example, in Pizza Hut, a CTO is reporting into the CMO, something which is unheard of, right? But it's working for the brand. Equally important is the single view of the customer. Today, what's happening is consumers are going online. For whatever reasons, they make the card and they drop out and they call up at the call center. And the guy that picks up the call at the call center has no idea who's calling. Ideally, consumers would expect that, the brand should know that the guy made a card online and now for whatever reason he's calling at the call center, and the guy should just say, okay, I can see your card, please go ahead, we'll just close your order. So all of these are the impacts that we are witnessing in our category. I'll just pick one example, I'm cognizant of time. How we leveraged the power of internet and we leveraged the power of social media last year. If you look at the might of the competitors, and India is a duopoly, right? So we were looking at one disruption in this category. And that disruption didn't come through TV, didn't come through any digital campaign, but it came through a social media campaign. So the day Sakshi Malik won the bronze medal for India in Olympics, and that was the first bronze medal, we thought that, we'll just invite everybody who has Sakshi name in her name. So Sakshi is a word in her name. We will invite all those Sakshis to come to a Pizza Hut store across the country, and we will give them a pizza for free. And it just became viral in, I would say, less than an hour's time. We were breaking the internet for 48 hours. And even in today's consumer work that we do, consumers tell us that the last ad from Pizza Hut that we recall is the one wherein you did something with Sakshi and something with Sindhu. So that's the journey that we have overtaken. And
it's really nice. So I don't think we're going to have time for that last question. Maybe you can ask them privately. You guys can't see it, but there's a sign here. It says you are over time by 3 minutes 23 seconds. Time is up. And then as you keep looking, we will get you. Then it says the police are waiting. Now it's saying we will kill your family. So I'm not. It's there, I'm telling you, you guys. So I value my family. So I want you guys to give a big round of applause to each of these people and everything we've heard. And I think you can.
Yeah. So I think before we summarize this session, we'll also open the house for question answers, because I'm sure that one of the few times when you get panelists such as this. But in the interest of time, we can take two questions to the maximum. If there are any questions in the audience that you'd like to ask the panelists.
So you allow two questions, and the best of them gets a free Business World subscription for the entire year. Okay, let's do this.
So hi, this question is to Anuja. So as all of you spoke about the ease to understand the behavior of the user on the internet and encashing the opportunities, at the same time you all understand that internet plays can be very detrimental also in terms of controlling the brand, in terms of damaging it. So sometimes we see videos posted against a brand. So how do you control that basically? What is your response to those kind of circulation which happens in the internet era, and whether you tend to respond to it immediately or have a lag to it and then respond it later wisely? That's what I want to understand, controlling a damage to the brand.
So if I understand your question correctly, your question is essentially about if there is a content piece that you put out to the consumer and it's not taken too well, how do you respond? Is that the question?
Images posted or video posted where we talk about, okay, this is more acidic, you can actually wash this, something like that, clean your house like this. So it also goes against the brand, right?
Yeah.
So controlling, first thing, like creating awareness about the among customer, saying that, okay, this brand is safe or something like that. And taking a control measures over that how we can prevent this to further circulate and damage the brand, basically.
So let me again answer this in two parts. The way we, I think what's really essential and what we're doing very actively at PepsiCo, one part of it is to be extremely active on the whole online listening piece. We've got an agency that tracks every commentary, every piece of commentary across our brands. And the brand teams are supposed to be, tracking the positive, negative and neutral commentary, looking at it, each of it individually. Pretty much twice a week, or three times a week. We've also got a team in place, that's responsible for responding to questions. So there are again two parts to it. There is one part which is fairly, is built on FAQs. When I'm launching a new product, I know there'll be a certain set of questions that the consumers would have. And so, it's obviously kind of logical to have answers ready for that. The second part of it is things that may just come up not in the right spirit, which are maybe, like you said, detrimental to the brand. There are again two approaches. I think one of it is when it's a genuine consumer concern, our turnaround time is 24 hours to that response. However, I think as a responsible brand, it's also important to understand that what is the intent behind any kind of content that's put out. You may not be able to control and respond to everything, and it's not maybe equally, the right thing to do. The consumers out there are very, very intelligent, let me tell you. Very often, when there are people who put out content that's not in our interest, there is equally a very strong, loyal base of consumers today, and that's the advantage of social media, who come to, your rescue, who are the ones who would come and talk about the great things that the brand is doing even before you do it. So I think it's constantly important for a brand to invest, into building the brand ethics and the brand on the social media so that you have your consumers come and talk about the good things that you're doing and you don't have to talk about it, virtuously. I think, just another aspect to your question, what we've also done very actively is to ensure, we've got a pact with Google to ensure that the brand narratives and the brand communication does not figure alongside or, figure with any objectionable content. That's, I think, an important piece that marketers need to be very, very careful of as to, what's coming alongside right before or, next to your content and how is that coloring the consumer's mind. I hope I answered your question.
All right, thank you. I think we'll have to close this in the interest of time. You can definitely take it offline, sir. Thank you very much to the panelists here. And let me please invite Mr. Rohan Mehta, CEO, Social Connect, to join us on the stage to present a small token or a memento to our panelists here. Thank you. Please, welcome in, Rohan. And we can put a round of applause for this wonderful discussion. We're sure that this was intriguing in lots of ways and gave you some new insights and thought processes to work towards a new perspective and take on the brand strategy further.